Okay, Father's bless.
Let's say a prayer. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. O heavenly King, the comfort of the Spirit of truth, who are everywhere, for the soft things, treasury of blessings, and giver of life. Come and abide in us, and cleanse us from every impurity, and save our soul for the one. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Nova speaks Serbian?
Oh, yeah. Some of us don't.
Mateo speaks English. And you speak English better than Serbian, I guess. Nemes.
My Serbian is better than English.
Just the
A few days ago, I was in New York, coming back from Florida, and when I used to live in New York 25, 30 years ago, there I converted, and I love New York because of that. I mean, I hate it because of all the bad things, and because New York killed some of my friends, although not New York, but the demons that live in New York. But I love it as well, because I found Christ right there in the heaven, which was something most important for me in my life. When I was heading for the United States as a young man, I could never imagine that this is going to happen to me, that my life would be completely changed. And so, as I was telling you yesterday, I was always looking for the higher meaning of life, but I thought it's in fun, in science, in money, in hedonism, whatever. But then, thank God, I found Christ in Manhattan streets and avenues, and that changed my life. And this actually happened in the church. It was OCA Church. In Manhattan, East 2nd Street, between 2nd and 3rd Avenue, it doesn't really matter. And it was a church of the protection of the Holy Virgin. It was a cathedral, OCA Cathedral, for New York and New Jersey. Why I was attending OCA Church and not Serbian one? But, you know, because we Serbs as people from Balkans, we are very emotional and very energetic sometimes. And those were years when the war was on in Yugoslavia. And unfortunately, my nation, Serbian nation, and unfortunately other nations in Yugoslavia were suffering, killing each other. It was a civil war, a terrible one. And I could understand, but in Serbian church, thanks, there was a lot of brandy, rakia, and politics. So it was not, I was not very into it in those days of my life. I was just freshly converted, and I was deep into the repentance of my life, of my youth. I realized I was really leading a very suicidal life, wrong way of living, and I was my need was actually prayer, repentance, reading the Holy Fathers, and as well being with people of a similar frame of mind. And in this church, OCA Cathedral in New York City. In Manhattan, you can imagine what kind of people used to live there, especially in those years. These were years 80s and 90s, and New York City was much more violent and sharp, and punk rock was at that time, and it was pretty dangerous to be in the streets. Now it's different. This mayor Giuliani managed to fix, you know, fix New York, to clean it and to make it more tame. But in those years, it was really really intense living in New York. Well, since I mentioned this topic, I will make a digression, if I say in English. You know what happened? New York was really wild and dangerous and sharp and provocative. But somehow it was much more interesting. You know why? I mean, I'm not saying that having criminals and drug dealers and junkies on the streets is something. But in a way, you know, being an narco addict, being a criminal, but mostly hooked on drugs, and all these punks on the streets and all these rebels, it meant somehow that there was still this rebellion in a young generation. You know, that young generation realized that this banksters, as they call them today, or these people that are leading this world, they are just have the only thing in their minds are just money and how to use other people to make more money. They call them, well, banksters. You know, they are bankers and gangsters at the same time. So in those times, young people, you know, they still had in a wide plane, you could see this rebellion. You know, they were saying, this is wrong. You know, the United States and the world, especially the Western world, are going to the wrong direction. You know, we should say, no, stop it. You know, don't do this. Don't make wars. Don't kill people all over the world just because you need, you know, oil to drive your trucks and your cars all over the United States. You know, and just don't make trouble all over the world. I mean, the United States is so big. We have everything here. You know, and it was a scream. It was a rebel scream of those poor young souls that they realized. And even those junkies on the streets were symbol of rebellion, of something deep into the human being, human soul, that they realized that the world is going in the wrong direction. Unfortunately, in the meantime, these last three decades, we see that this power of this world, of the rulers of this world, you know, people who are actually holding the majority of money. They say only in London there is maybe 50% of all money in the world, and the rest is most likely in New York City. You can see how low a man fell in animal, just it's just animal craving for materialistic and bodily, you know, pleasures, nothing else, nothing spiritual, nothing. They do not know how to feed their souls anymore. So now when you go through New York City, only now and then you can see somebody who is a little bit different. They're all now, you know, molded. Everybody's put in a certain mold. Is this how you say mold? When you cast something in a mold, and they're all the same now. They're like zombies. They're like slaves. You know, they're working for these big districts and these big buildings, for this big corporations. They don't know who they are, what they are doing, where they are going. Why do they do that? You know, you see, there's no young man who is a little bit different, who says, no, I don't want to participate in this ideology. I will live in New York. I mean, that's where I'm born, and I will go for a job and for school. But I really refuse to think this way. This is really very, very dangerous, you know, to consent, to bow down in front of this idol of this world. And the idol of this world is money and everything that you can get with money, by money. And this idolatry is really terrible. Because God is really the real spirituality. You know, today when we somebody says, oh, we are spiritual. What do you mean? They don't know what that is saying. You know? To be spiritual means to carry a certain spirit in yourself. And we know very well what is the real spirit. This is the spirit of the creator of the universe. God's spirit, called Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost. The third person of most holy day. No any other spirit. Any other spirits are just spirits of evil and darkness. So when somebody says, oh, I'm spiritual, he doesn't know what he's talking about. They're spiritual, but they're possessed by spirits of this world, which is karma, just karma, not spiritual. So they can freely say, oh, we are karma. And so it's kind of sad, you know, for me to see this now. This you know, when you iron your clothing, so the New York youth is ironed. You know, they do not think with their minds anymore. They think with money and what they are told from these big corporations. But anyway, I still love that place because I remember this smell, this taste of the Holy Spirit who entered in me and saved my life. And especially, it is almost the same period of the year as June, where the lime tree blossoms and there's this beautiful smell. I used to live in Brooklyn, Williamsburg, just across the East River, because it was cheaper than Manhattan. And most of artists, they were actually moving to the other side of East River because it was much cheaper to have an artist studio. And this area of Brooklyn was had, you know, how was it called, a bit of it? The road, the tree road, you know, right down the street. And there were lime trees, a lipa lime tree. And it was smelling beautiful. and especially in these moments of my life in New York, I was just converted to faith. So whenever you are new in faith, when you're fresh in faith, then the amount of grace is strong and really fulfills you. Especially myself and those similar to myself who lived very, very simple life. That's why God sends you a strong amount of grace just to wake you up, to say, you see, there's something much better. And I remember I was so full of this beautiful feeling of joy and finally I found the meaning of life and everything was so bright for me and life was so beautiful. I loved everybody. And right maybe a few weeks before that or months before that, I was in such a gloomy state of my mind. I was thinking about suicide. Everything is wrong, everything is false, everything is a big lie, which is really wrong, you know. The life is beautiful. You just get to find a right stance where you're going to stand and say, yes, this direction is good and life is beautiful. And people are good, everything is okay. And this feeling of fullness of God's grace mingled with this smell of lime tree. And it was so beautiful. So from that year, all these years, until this day, whenever I smell this beautiful smell, it brings me back, you know. In psychology, you can find that smells can bring up memories very vividly. And so I was going I think it was 3rd Avenue, going downtown from Grand Central Station, from 42nd Street, and the lime tree was smelling beautiful. And I felt, you know, somehow nice. And finally, I reached East 2nd Street, where this old cathedral, Osier Cathedral, was. And for my great joy, I found Father Christopher, who at that time was, assistant. He was assistant of the priest, Father Makar himself. He was a Catalonian, I called him Catalonian Orthodox Cardinal. Beautiful man. He was an archmandrite here as a monk. And at that time, Brother Christopher was his assistant. Then he became deacon when I was still there, and then he became priest, and he was a parish priest in heaven. And so when I entered the church, and when I saw the interior of the church, and I remember, and there were my icons that I, some of my first icons, because I was I'm an icon painter, and that in that church there was a Brother Daniel, Brazilian, who was an Orthodox Christian as well, and he was icon teacher, he taught me icons, so it was great joy of my life, because I was an artist always, but I was always wondering what branch of art should I choose for myself. You know? And when I found iconography, it was one of the greatest joys in my life. So all those beautiful moments of my life are connected to this church. So it was like a time machine. It was just a few days ago, and I didn't know I'm going to react so emotionally. But it was really a great change in my life in a positive direction. And I remember fondly this visitation to this church. But anyway, okay, let's go back to the topics that we should talk about. So it is very important, since you're young men and girls, that you're just entering their lives, and as they say, the life. Whole life is in front of you, and this is not easy thing at all. It's a very serious thing that we should seriously think about that, and how are we going to enter this majestic path. And could be majestic, could be very disastrous. It unfortunately happens very often. One of the most important things is that we should be born, of course, it doesn't depend on you, that if we are born in Orthodox, active Orthodox family or not. If we are, that's a great advantage, because from the early age, the early years, as you see, sorry, I don't know how does it sound in English, we are faced and acquainted with the church life, which is extremely important. The church life is, the church is actually, I love to say, for Orthodox Christianity, is the supreme psychotherapy. You know, we are all more or less sick or disturbed, even when we are very young. We realize that very often we are disturbed, insecure in certain moments, and we all need some kind of healing. We are not sick, of course. I mean, especially not you, you're young, still healthy, beautiful, clever. But very often we realize in certain moments we are not so secure in ourselves. We are not so stable. And it means that we need to be healed in a way, to be more strong and self-confident. And I'm sure in this state that Orthodoxy is a supreme psychotherapy. What do I mean by that? That it gives you strength to go through all the temptations, and life is full of temptations. The life is actually going from temptation into temptation. And these small parts without temptation are just preparing for another one. But it's good, you know, life is struggle, and it's good. You know, when we struggle, we really feel that we are alive. And when we were just inactive, passive, it's not life. And it's just nothing. It's like a live process. So it's really important when we are acquainted with the church life from the very beginning. You know what is confession, you know what is fasting, you know what is going to liturgy, doing communion. These are all very important things to have sound and healthy soul and spirit. And very often, when somebody didn't go through this period of early learning what the church is, can be very scandalized and think when somebody is adult And he enters the church and he wants to be an active Orthodox Christian. And so when you tell him, you know, one of the first and important things is confession. You know, you open your heart, your inner being, and to say openly. Very often people say, what am I here to confess? I'm not a sinner, you know, I didn't kill anybody, I didn't steal, I didn't burn anybody. So they don't know what a confession really is. So when we are from the early age learning what a confession is, of course that little kid, 6 or 7 years old, doesn't really have to confess something. Right. But he learns and it becomes normal to him to confess. And only when we get older, we realize how beautiful a thing is a confession, when you open yourself to the priest, and actually not to the priest, but through the priest, to the creator of the universe, to God. And then even psychology, not psychiatry, God forbid you enter, you end up to some of those ambulances or offices of psychiatry, you will see that the interview is something most important in a process of mental healing. But confession is actually the supreme and the most healthy way of interview. And of course, it is extremely important to be obedient to elders, especially in the first place to our parents. Indeed, in today's society, we realize extremely wrong and decadent way of teaching children how they are supposed to be. How they are supposed to react towards their parents. Today it is said almost you are not obliged to listen and to be obedient to your parents because they are old fashioned, you don't have to listen to them, very, very often they don't love you, they don't molest you, they don't abuse you, just listen to us, government. And these are those gangsters that they want you as slaves, they want you to separate you from your parents or from somebody who is older, who is more wise, who is more experienced. In the guise of, let's say, modern times, you know, this way you're going to be more successful in society. And it is so dangerous, you know, when you accept this way of thinking that you should do as you want. You should do as you think, and you are young. The thing is that you were present here. I'm sure you're more clever than I am, let's say. But what is my advantage, or father's, or his advantage, in front of, in comparison with you? A life experience. So you're probably, your IQ is bigger than mine. But my advantage is that I have life experience. And life experience is extremely important. And we should listen to those who have life experience. And especially if he's not a moron, if he's a normal person, if he is a person from the church. They have a spiritual education and they have life experience. And of course, they want us to be good. They kako se kaže na engleskom? De oni nam misle dobro. Kako se kaže?
They have the best intentions.
Excuse me? Yeah, they wish you the best. They wish you the best. And that means that we should listen to them and never to listen to the government and what they teach us in school. If your father or if your mother is whatever towards you, you have right to go into to police station or to social worker and to say my father is molesting me. It's, I don't want to say this, it's terrible, you know, because even if my father is sometimes nervous or my mother is not physically well, maybe she yells at me, she loves me, my God, she loves me. Maybe she doesn't react always in the same manner, but she really loves me. And if I am obedient to her, maybe she's not going to be right in any moment in my life. But through my obedience, through my humility, through me being humble in front of my mother, my father, my grandfather, in front of my priest. Then through this humility, but humility has a pretty bad connotation, through being humble, being obedient, God sees this and He sends His grace. And then we mature gradually. We gradually enter the life. When I was young, in Belgrade, 1970s, when I was a teenager, in the 80s, when I was a young man, it was very in to have to want everything right now. You know, there was a rock band, and he was singing, "I want everything, and I want it right now." What does it mean? It's nonsense. You cannot have everything, and you cannot have it right now. You should grow slowly, gradually, and then you become strong and serious person and experienced person, how do you call this? How do you say that?
Mushroom,
like a mushroom. You know, mushroom grows in one night. And in the morning, in the evening there was nothing. In the morning there was a mushroom. There is a mushroom, but it withers easily. But a strong oak tree, first it is small, it looks like grass, and then it grows slowly, and then finally it becomes so strong, there is no tornado or anything that can harm it. This is what happens with us. If you want to grow fast, if you want to have everything in right away, we will burn very fast, and nothing will stay. Or we will stay alive, but like degenerated personalities. And that what happened with a lot of friends, a big number of my friends. They wanted everything fast. They didn't want to listen to their parents, to their grandparents, to church, to anybody. They thought they are the most clever in the world. And there is a saying in Serbia, "Only fool knows everything." A clever man knows that he, let's say, we're not going to say that he thinks that he doesn't know anything, but that he is very, that he doesn't know everything. Clever man knows that he doesn't know everything and that he has to learn. So it is very important to crush our pride as a young person, to be obedient to our parents, to the church, and slowly we will receive God's grace, which will give us the strength to go forward. Yes?
Please help us understand, in my own life experience working with children for over 40 years, sometimes people in authority in the church will use that authority to lead children astray, and sometimes verbally leading into abusive situations.
Yes.
Within the context of the family.
Yeah, that's right.
And it leaves the children totally devastated as to who should I be listening to. And I've seen with many of my brother priests, they wash their hands of the situation. They don't want to get involved. This is the family, not only.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we have sick people, sick parents. In these cases, it is hard, it is difficult, but then we should look for help in the church and in God. You know, we should look after God to help us. But I'm sure, let's say here, among these young people, that they're probably coming from parents that they consented to their coming here, and they're more or less normal, not as Christians, traditional people. Unfortunately, somebody could be born in a family with drug addicts, alcoholics, crazy people. That's really hard. But I'm not a wonder worker, and I'm not the most the cleverest man in this world that I have solution for every problem. I'm just saying that I believe and I understand, and I want to believe that that much sanity that we can say, okay, there is a problem in my family. I will still love my father who is, let's say, sick, he's an alcoholic. Of course, if he tortures me, if he uses me, if he molests me, then it's an extra situation. Then I will find help in help, let's say. But very often, our parents are normal people. You know, maybe not the perfect ones, but still, being obedient to them, loving them, trying to help them with our obedience, with our love, praying for them, God can help us. But if I say, I don't want to listen to him, I want to go somewhere to the safe house, that's how they call it, those homes now in Europe, then I will participate in destroying of my family. So there we have to be very, very, very cautious and always to be open to the Lord's help. You know, to have our little prayer at home, to go to church, and God will help us. Here, that Father mentioned, is really, there are families that are completely out of the presence of God, you know, and every deterioration or degeneration or whatever happens in such a family. Unfortunately, especially in the Western world, unfortunately, especially in the United States. We in this country, we are always in extremes. In the beginning, centuries ago, in first half and in 20th century, there was this extreme of crazy parents abusing their children, husbands abusing their wives, torturing their husbands, and it was one extreme. And it was wrong, because of course, we always come to the same point. Christ was expelled from society, especially in the Western Church. Never in Orthodox Church. But unfortunately, the Western Church, doesn't matter is it Roman Catholic or Protestant, holds this country in their power. So it's really it's not Christianity anymore. They just call themselves church, but it's not church. The only church with big capital C is Orthodox Church. These are all religious organizations, whatever. So this was one extreme. And then, of course, society noticed that it's going crazy. And now, instead of being in the middle way, as the Holy Father said, now we are going in the 21st century in another extreme that now nobody can say anything. So a parent cannot say anything to his child with a little bit higher voice, stronger voice, you know. It's all already a child abuse, you know. You cannot say young man if he is, where he works, for example, in the office or somewhere. He cannot say a nice compliment to a nice-looking lady. You know, he's not allowed to say, "Oh, you're looking nice. You're so beautiful today," because it's a sexism, or how they call it. And this is the problem. Nobody is. Nobody is married. Married anybody anymore. There is no boy and girl anymore being together, because you are not allowed to say anything nice, you know. And now I was reading in the airplane. There was a magazine, airplane magazine, when there are these persons who are matching people. It's so you know ridiculous. On one hand side, we are forbidding each other to give compliments, and of course, we are all afraid, you know, and there's no matching in a normal, natural way, and that's why we have persons who are matching people, you know. I know her, you know, I know what kind of personality she is, and then I know him, and that way I'm matching them, you know. It's so, I have no privilege to express my you know, So everything is upside down. So that's why I'm saying that we are in this society, we are all the time going to extremes. And there is not this beautiful middle way which we can always find in the church. So that's why I'm saying, well, we should listen to our parents, read books, holy books for the fathers, talk to all elderly people who are saved, who kept their minds clear and normal, going sometimes to the our old country, Serbia, or Bosnia, or Herzegovina, Montenegro, talking to elderly people, to learn about history, to learn historical books, to read about moral ethics, normal way of life. Sometimes to go to retreats like this, to listen to people from the church. And this way, we are going to save ourselves. And no matter what this crazy world is saying to us, we will stay normal, and we will lead more or less normal and healthy life. And it's not easy, it's not easy to live, especially in the United States, work here, and all these abnormal things are going on. But still, you know, there are many Americans, you know. Sometimes we say, oh, America is guilty for everything. No, there are many Americans. You're American, he's American. Father is one American. How many people? As many people, that many Americans. And it all means, it really all means, with whom do we live with, whom do we listen to, and we have to choose. When I was in California, in Florida, I don't know if I was talking to this yesterday about this. There's this Serbian rap band, all Serbs, maybe a few. I was curious about that. It's so terrible. Father from, I think it was Northport or I don't remember. He showed me this video spot, this music spot of this band. You know, you can see that they're completely lost young men. You know? Most likely they're coming from parents who are most of the day on their jobs. They don't have time for their children. So they are going out on the streets. They're gathering together. Being together. They're consoling each other, you know. But they are going into the drugs, into criminal, and now they have this rap band. It's so ugly. It's so poor. You know, you feel sorry for them. They think it's something, you know, rebellious. It's something, but it's so terrible. And he was wearing one. He was the leader of the band. I don't know his name. It was Sasha Mikhailovich or something like this. I don't know. He was wearing these pants, you know, blue jeans, which are very low. It's so him to wear it this way. And under his belt there was a pistol and a knife. And it's so him. He's a great hero. Terrible. And you know that he's not going to stay alive maybe in the next 5 years. And if he stays, he will be with his brain burned completely. So I'm talking too much. So is there any question about what I was just talking about?
Sometimes I have to kind of keep tabs on what's out there in the media so that I can interact with our youth groups, not just with my church, but
yeah, different groups. Yeah.
So I kind of can talk with them about what's going on. Some of the shows that are on TV.
They what?
Some of the reality shows that are on TV.
Uh-huh.
The Bachelorette, The Bachelor. What's the one? Never Met, First Time Married. People actually come together, don't know one another, and get married.
Yeah.
It's glorified. On the network about how wonderful two total strangers lead to marriage. But you never hear about how they live their life.
Yeah.
It's craziness. It's absolute craziness. The Bachelorette, The Bachelor, I mean, the ratings they did, this blows up my mind. Have people who actually wants this stuff.
It's really hard to live and to grow in this kind of society, but still, you know, thank God we have church and we have places like this, and we from the church should be more serious, more organized, and organize these kind of meetings more and to be with more
absolutely
young people, you know, and it's the best thing to match, you know, to meet
absolutely
and to be good friends and even to make to become a boy or girl,
yep,
you know, and one day to make a marriage from these contacts. And so God is there, church is there, and we should really be present and clever, and we should really read a lot. We should really read Holy Fathers. Thank God, when I was young, 70s, 80s, in Serbia, in Belgrade, there was no book, basically, on what is Christianity. Everything, Zen Buddhism, Buddhism, even Roman Catholic charismatic movement, even that you could find, you know, and every kind of ism is, and you know, philosophy, but not what is Christianity. Why? Because it was the biggest enemy of this world, of this karma world. But thank God, communism passed away. Now we are living in this neoliberal, neoliberal
movement. But today there are no moral absolutes anymore. Anyone can do whatever they want to do in society, especially America.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just saying, who are you to tell me what I can or can't do?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I have my own rights.
Yeah.
And, but when everybody has rights, then nobody.
Right.
I remember that there was a was a neoliberal capitalism and pseudo democracy. It's just everything about democracy. When I was still living in the United States, in New York, and there was a friend of mine who was married to a French girl, and she converted to Orthodoxy, and they had a little baby. And they used to live in Brooklyn. It was mixed neighborhood, blacks, whites, Puerto Ricans, whatever, but it was kind of decent. And so the child was sleeping, the baby was sleeping, and across the street, sitting on the steps of his home, there was a black guy listening to this cassette player.
Boombox.
Yeah, something like that. And it was allowed, you know. And in the beginning, she was waiting, maybe he's going to turn it a little bit lower, but he didn't. And she knew it is a very risky situation, but she had to. She went out, she approached him, and she tried to be as polite as possible. And said, my friend, I'm sorry, and whatever she said, like, can you make it just a little bit lower, my baby is sleeping? He said, what do you mean? I have my own rights. And he turned it even more than that. And that's democracy. So he has his own rights, but then the child doesn't have it's rights. So this is the when everybody has their own rights, and this pseudo democracy, this is demonocracy, as we say. And so yeah, that's what it is. It's really hard, but I'm always saying it's hard, but it's not impossible. It is possible, and God will help us. Yes.
Were you able to help bring your friends across the drug addicts at the time, or?
Louder.
Were you able to convert any of your friends who were also drug addicts at the time, or did you were able to help them?
In the very beginning, when I converted in New York, of course I couldn't, because I didn't have myself. I was still sick. And I didn't even have a moral stance that I tell them, because I was the same people as they were. Although I changed, and with my appearance, I managed to change some of them. First year, I withdrew in my apartment. I didn't go anywhere, because I needed this period of silence and being secluded. Being reading Holy praying a lot, and I was, I think I was crying every night for a year and a half while I was still living in Brooklyn. I was really crying. During the day I was reading, doing a little bit. I had this opportunity not to work every day, but when night would come, I would start praying, and then I was weeping many hours during the night, not of despair, but of being ashamed what kind of life I was living, and out of immense happiness, as I was telling you yesterday. And for a year, I was separated from the company I was with, those years in New York. And then after a year, I realized I'm stable enough to go out again. And then friends of mine, they realized the change in me, and they saw that I'm kind of brighter the time that I was. And I was not smoking, I was not taking drugs, I was living a decent life. But I was still with them, and I was one of them. So it was interesting to them what happened with me. And slowly, some of them, who were more mature in a spiritual way, they started to approach and to ask, what happened to you? So it was a kind of influence that I had. But I didn't take anybody and say, oh, you know, you're a sinful man, you're a sinner, repent, you know, listen to me. You know, I wouldn't manage to do anything to them. But with our own examples, we can help a lot. We can help a lot. We should work on ourselves, we should change, we should become real Christians, very tolerant, loving everybody, not accusing anybody, but with our appearance, with our example, we show that they are not doing right to themselves. And many years after that, with long experience of my own repentance, with the struggle with my own personality, it was many years. Because I was, as I told you, I was living a very sinful life as a young man. I needed many years, maybe 20 years, to fight with myself within the walls of the monastery and to heal myself. And after 20 years, it happened that God allowed me to go out and to try to help. And only with the blessing of all the church, all my bishop, all my abbot, all my spiritual leaders, I dared to try to listen to others now and to try to give them solutions. And then it happened, so 6 or 7 years ago, when I went to Montenegro, the monastery of Rostov. Before that, I was 5 years in I was living as a hermit in a hermitage in up in the mountains. It is a triangle of Serbia, Montenegro, and Kosovo. There was a monastery in Black River, Cetareka, and there was my hermitage up there in the mountains. There I lived. It was the crescendo, as they say, a culmination of my monastic life. Before that, it was 15 years in a common life monastery, and then, as I always long desired this secluded life, I lived in these mountains for 5 years, and it was intense spiritual life. I was very often faced with demonic powers, and of course with the beautiful powers of Holy Spirit. And then, after those 20 years, I went to Monastery Rostov, and I received this blessing to work with people. Although I'm not in priesthood, like I'm just a simple monk. But with this experience of life, Metropolitan Filohia, who is a spiritual leader and bishop of Montenegro, he realized that he gave his blessing to do that. So, last 6 years, I'm doing this. You know, I receive people are coming, especially in Ostrog, because Ostrog is famous for people who have serious life problems. And most of them are pretty much like a life tragedies. They're, you know, first, unfortunately, they're going to some witches and witchcrafts and, you know, in the old continent, they're loaded. I see in New York, you know, psychic and this. It's stupidity. general, when you go to psychic or listen to those witches and whatever the hell they are called in English, I don't know, you always go deeper and deeper. You're in connection with the devil. Sometimes they can see something. They can, как се каже, погоди нещо.
Yes.
They can guess, yeah, but a demon helps them. But in the long run, they're always harm themselves, and they harm others that they are listening to them. So in Ostrov, there people are coming first, now really greatly harmed by those false healers. Then they go to psychiatrists. Then they get addicted to medicaments, which is also sometimes you have to take them, but most of the time you can go without them, just a prayer. Then they do whatever, and then finally they're coming to church, they're coming to ask. They say, okay, now I came to the verge of my life, okay, I'm going to go to the monastery and ask a monk, maybe he can help. And then we can help. You know? And so these people are coming, they used to come to the monastery, Montenegro, to Ostrov, and then first of all, you have to listen to them, you know, what is their problem? Anamnesis, how it is called in medicine. Then, most cases, you realize they are spiritual problems. It's not a real mental illness, which is a problem with biochemistry of your brain. It's really a spiritual problem. And if it is a spiritual problem, you cannot solve it with chemistry. There is a spiritual approach. Then you explain them. Very often it is a demonical origin, demonic powers that they are torturing us. And then you tell them how they should fight against it, that they shouldn't be afraid of it. That everything is we cannot help ourselves. We just have to take those antidepressants. Or sedatives, and that's for the rest of our lives. That's not true. Then you tell them how they are fighting, how they are supposed to fight, with the prayer that they said yesterday. And slowly they are getting healed and their lives are changing. And thank God, I had many cases, that people are completely changed. You know, you receive them, for example, they came, you know, 2 months ago with completely gray and dark face, you know. State, gloomy mood, you know, completely in despair, you know, everything is gone, life doesn't have any meaning, you know. And then, with the help of prayer, our guidance, and then I give them a prayer rule. Prayer rule is extremely important thing. On one side, you should enter a liturgical life, on the other side, you should do your daily prayers. And then, let's say every 20 days or once a month, they are supposed to call and to say, how does it work? Because it's not an easy thing, especially for somebody who is not acquainted with the church. And then, you know, he says, oh, Father, when I read this prayer, this happens to me, or when I go to communion, this happens to me, or when I stand in church, that happens to me. Then we try to tell them, okay, this is because of that, this is because of this, do not be afraid, be strong, be brave. Demons usually don't like when we enter the path of Christian change in our lives. So this way, with the help of God, with the help of prayer in the church, and with the help of spiritual leader, people change. And then in 2 months, 6 months, 1 year, you know, the girl comes, you can't recognize her. Can just recognize her because she really changed in a positive way. And these are one of the most beautiful moments of my life when I realized that I'm not nobody, I'm nothing, I'm just a worm. With God's help, we can help. And that's really a beautiful moment. And it gives me strength to continue. Because the greatest joy for myself is when I taste God's love in prayer. But the second joy, not far away from this one, is when I can convey, if, I can help other to find Christ and not to be connected to me as a guru, but I'm just there to direct towards Christ. And that's about it. I don't want him or her to be, you know, in my possession all their lives. I don't need it. This belongs to gurus and false heroes. We Christian, Orthodox Christian priests and monks and spiritual leaders, we are not, we do not want those souls to belong to us. We want to direct those souls to belong to Jesus Christ. This is our goal. And only this way we can find solution for all our problems. As it says in the title of this meetings, ancient solutions for modern problems. Actually, modern problems are at the same time ancient problems, because man as a human being is always the same.
Yeah.
You know. And the ancient solutions are very fresh and modern to these days. It is just said this way, sounds interesting, but it is all the man. Yesterday I was in Museum of Fine Arts in Cleveland, and I saw those busts in bronze and in portraits in stone, and you see these people 2,000 years ago, 2,500 years ago, 3,000 years ago, they're absolutely like people today. They're not monkeys, they're not apes, they're not, you know, no, they're absolutely like we are. And you see in their eyes, in their faces, that they had similar problems, same life disappointments, and same life joys. And you see the man is always the same. Same problems and same solutions. Thank God, after Christ's advent, after the beginning of Christianity, we have the most powerful weapon towards this world, which is very often very hostile to us. So are you greatly bored with me and sleepy and waiting? Okay, let's stop this, go out. Do something more like that. Okay, so the hippie just do you speak to him?
No.
No? So how old are you?
16.
16. You're in high school?
Yes.
And do you have any plans for your future?
Hopefully college or in ROTC, then army.
And then army. And what is this ROTC? What are
you doing with this? It's like you go to college, you get a degree, and you learn how to be an officer in the military, so you have a higher rank when you go.
So basically you want to enter military.
And then I want to be an engineer.
Nothing that you can do with this
officer.
So you're going to study military science as well today?
Yes.
And whom do you live with? Friends? Brothers, sisters?
Sisters in college. At house, they have my home.
And how are you together? I mean, how are you dealing with each other? Is it easy? You know, a lot of fighting and yelling at each other, or?
No.
No.
Right.
I can't. She bought me. She buys me stuff, so.
What happened? She buys
me stuff. She buys me stuff, so I can't be mad at her.
Okay, and so are they going to church, your parents?
Yes, they are.
And you too?
Always.
Always?
Every Sunday.
That's nice. And is it boring to you, or are you just...
I like it.
You like it. That's nice. And what about you? How old are you?
15.
And what are your plans?
To go to college.
College is actually something in general, something that does very... to je nešto kao...
Da, u Srbiji to je kao samo nešto da se lepite s
ono svi. Yeah, but that is not a specific science there. Right. It's just...
Ne, ali to je to je jedan
na svoj. And what else are you doing? Are you interested in something?
I'm going to be a doctor.
A doctor? Anything like that. And how are you, where are you from Chicago?
Yes.
And how are you spending your free time? go out with your friends? Do you spend sometimes early in the evening? When do you come home, for example, when you go out?
On school days, I normally come home
around
5 or 6 o'clock.
So I heard that there is a joke. When a young man goes out with a girl, he should have Xanax.
Xanax.
Because when Xanax goes away from her, she goes mad. She goes mad. You know, so he has to give her another one.
Never.
Yeah, there was a friend of mine from Chicago who told me this. Of course. It's around these sick poor girls, but did you ever come across young people who are living not
very
well? Yeah. So do you go sometimes to nightclubs or
no?
No. So that's good. Thank God, you know, this is a nice and helpful year. What was your call group?
18.
And do you speak Serbian?
No.
No. But you're Serbian?
Yeah.
Both parents?
No, only one.
Excuse me?
Only one.
Only one. And another one?
Italian.
Italian. Do you speak Italian?
Partially. Working on
that. And who is also yours?
Other both my parents.
Oh, they're both Orthodox. Uh-huh. And who is Serbian?
My dad is
Serbian. Your dad is Serbian. And your mother converted?
Yes.
That's interesting. And how do you spend your free time? What do you do? Watching internet, surfing internet?
Yeah.
Yeah, you do? What kind of problem? What
topics? Sometimes for free time I'll work on programming.
What do you like to do to watch? What do you like to do? Nothing, whatever comes.
Yeah.
Whatever comes. Sometimes it can be dangerous, you know that?
Yeah.
Sometimes you can come to the problems that are not really not just pornography. I don't mean that. Of course, that's obviously disgusting. But there are those programs, for example, for being peaceful, for harmony, for meditation, listening to some nice music, repeating certain words. Did you ever come across these programs?
See an ad for something for meditation, like
something like that.
Just
yeah, it's very present. I had several cases, people were doing those kind of meditations. In any kind of meditation, actually, especially on that, you're opening yourself. You're opening yourself, you're thinking, you're doing something spiritual, as you mentioned, and you're thinking you're going to get harmony with your own self, as they used to say. You're going to get peaceful because this life is so turbulent. But in these moments, it's very dangerous. Those foreign spirits can go through these meditations and possess you, not you, of course. But I had this, you know, there was a case with a woman, a young woman. She was listening to this. She was born in France, but she grew up in the States. And she was listening to this, and all of a sudden, through listening to this, just the music, and then some kind of, he was telling you now where you concentrate on your breathing and things like this, you know. And it looks like very, very benign, I would say. Benign, very, very, not very dangerous, you know. felt like something was entering. And then she, actually, she urinated. She couldn't stop her urine. And from that moment on, she was like possessed. And it was not only kiss. Because through this opening yourself in a spiritual way, especially in those meditations, you cannot discern what kind of spirit is approaching you. And a lot of harms can happen through this meditating, these programs you can find and of course, a lot of sects, a lot of satanist sects, there are these sects, they're very present in ex-Yugoslavian countries. They're telling you to young people, you know, this life is, doesn't have any meaning. And Satan is actually an older brother of Jesus Christ. And he's supposed to be the main one. So the Christians cheated us. And Satan is the one who is actually our friend. And you go, and you can, you are going to communicate and to be one with him when you kill yourself. There's a lot of cases of suicide, young people, and you just find it on the internet. And, of course, pornography, straight pornography, hetero and homosexual. So it is really very risky to surf through this. And very often we are looking for something, you know, specific and something that really can have a cost. Useful, something can be useful. But very often we can come across with something very hurtful. And it's much better to read some book, especially if you don't want to read something from church, then read something which is classical, that you can really get virtues, something really that some real I'm losing my English. Values, real values of this world. Reading Dostoevsky, many Serbian writers, whatever. Today nobody is reading books anymore. Just something quickly you can. Nobody has time to read a book of 100 or 200 pages. But it's extremely important, and especially qualifiers. So that's why we can grow really in a strong personality. It's good, of course, to see internet as well. But to go in extreme is sickness. You know that there is this addiction on internet. Now it's in books, in psychiatric books, you have. Gambling, alcohol, drugs, internet. So we have to be very careful about all these things. So how come you speak Serbian?
My parents speak Serbian.
Yeah. And you were born in the United States.
I'm supposed to be very small. Also, some of the countries are still in the Philippines.
Yeah, but sometimes. Kids don't want to speak Serbian. Yeah. You know, they're developing. You know?
Yeah.
But it's very good. You know, every language is a wealth. Even if you speak Swahili or Bani, whatever, it's a wealth. Especially if it is your native language. So teach your children Serbian.
Of course.
Anyway, they're going to speak English rather than Serbian.
Yeah.
Anyway. So this fear of parents, we're speaking English at home because you know there should be members of the society. Of course they're gonna be members of the society. So okay. I know we are approaching the any other questions? Yes.
I know like yoga is like a huge thing here where people just go like yoga classes.
To yoga.
Yeah. Do you think it's like not even possible to practice it without risking yourself to like your
You mean Hatha Yoga? Hatha Yoga is yoga with a stance, with actually just physical postures. Yeah, it's called Hatha Yoga. You know, yoga is belongs to Far East religion and philosophy. It is Hinduism. comes from Hinduism, and it's a spiritual practice, which is in form of bodily postures, forms. And since it is spiritual, you know, certain spirits inspired those people in the far past to project them and to create this philosophy, and especially Hatha Yoga, which is, and today, you know, they say, oh, Hatha Yoga is good, you know, it's good for your joints, it's good for your body, it's healthy for your organs. Maybe it is, in this, on that level. But even Hatha Yoga, which is the most, how do you say, non-dangerous way of yoga, it's not mantra, you do not meditate, you do not do things, you know, you do not go in sex, because there are forms of yoga when they do sex. You know, it is called, even this Hatha Yoga, only with physical movements, is actually a product of certain spirits. And those spirits are evil spirits. You know, somebody's going to say, oh, those Christians, everything is evil to them, everything is sin. Well, unfortunately, it is. You know, especially Hinduism, they have millions of gods, let's say. And all those gods have their names. And, but we know there are not millions of gods, there's only one god. And majority of those gods, let's say, they're just demons, they're fallen angels. And unfortunately, these Hindu people, you know, they're very nice people, very spiritual in a way. You know, our great saint, Saint Nikolai of Zhicha, he was saying that if Hindu people, if they would, convert into Christianity, paradise would be full of Hindus, because they are very nice, refined people, they are very spiritual. But unfortunately, just because of that, all those hosts of demons fell on that big peninsula, they created this yoga. And even when you do yoga today, you are under the influence of those spirits. You know, very often they teach you, when you do yoga, then you concentrate, you know, breathing and things like this. And then you're opening yourself, as I was telling you, as I was telling you before. So it's not naive at all. And if you want to have your body healthy, then there are a lot of other ways to go to gym, you know, walk, swim, run, you know, do whatever it is. It belongs to our culture. We don't need it. And because I was doing yoga for many years, I was meditating for many years, and I have right and experience to tell that this is not healthy. It is, especially during the meditation, with mantra, you know, there is a mantra called the mantra. It's a word that you repeat many hundreds, thousands of times when you meditate, you concentrate on this. Most of those mantras are actually the names of those gods, and they're actually the memes. So you find yourself repeating hundreds of thousands of times in your life the name of certain demons that they are coming from that part of the world. It's extremely dangerous. And very often they are telling you, lose yourself, lose your mind, lose your personality, dissolve in universal cosmic energy. What does it mean? Lose your personality. I don't want to lose my personality. My God brought me from non-being into being. And I want to go back to non-being. And this is actually, this dissolving as a drop in the ocean, this is dissolving. Unfortunately, to them, you cannot go into non-being, you just go to hell. And this is the most terrible thing when you deal with those Far East religions. So just keep to Christ. And when you, you know, I was deeply, for many years, into Far East religions, yoga, meditation, things like this. And I thought that this is something most serious, most mystical that human being can reach. Then, thank God, finally, when I discovered Orthodox Christianity, I realized this is much, much more mystical and spiritual than this Far East. Then, I only then I realized how this is poor. It's like a child game. You know, all this, you know, cheap spirituality. Orthodox Christianity is so spiritual, so mystical in a healthy way. With one hand, you know, on one side, you are on heavens, and on another, you are strongly on earth, which is extremely important. You know, if you're only on earth, karma is not good. If you're only in heavens, you know, in spiritual, it's not good as well. We need to be spiritual, even mystical, but also sober, and with both legs on this earth. Then it means that we are going to be in spirit and in this world, which is, of course, we are born here, we are material. And yeah, I know. Many, even today, it's an official teaching of today's medicine that you know, yoga, meditation, pranayama, breathing. It's a great thing. Why are demons he? Maybe Because we still believe that woman is more nice than man. That she should be more clean, pure, softer, nicer. Yeah. So that's why when you say demon, somehow it's not she. You know, she should be something nicer. I think that's about it.
Is it because, like, in our tradition, we see like the male gender as like the dominance?
Excuse me, what?
Is it because, like, in our like church and everything, it's always like the male dominance?
No, she just said that angels are without gender. Sometimes they say he appears as a young man, but actually the church says they don't have sex. And we are going to be this way when we enter another world. We are not going to have digestion organs and procreative organs.
We will be new spiritual beings, right?
What?
We will be new spiritual beings.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And yeah, it's true that the male is dominant, and as it says in the Holy Scriptures, that God is head of the husband, and the husband is head of his wife. But there is another part of it that it's not said in the Holy Scriptures, but Holy Father continue, and they say that the woman is the heart of her husband. And then it's complete. So, you know, a male is dominant only because he's active and woman is passive. You know? But this is the rule, this is the king. This is how it goes. And it's good. You know? But in many marriages, maybe he looks like he's dominant, but the clever wife is not. And she doesn't use that in the wrong way, you know. So, let's say, okay, in our church we do not have women as a priestess, which comes not from Christianity, but even from Judaism, from the first and most important monotheistic religion. And we should be obedient to that. That must be something serious in there. It's all divided. You know, a woman has this most important role to give birth. It doesn't mean that she's creature to give birth and just take care of children. No. But this is something most important. And I can tell you, we see this crazy world. Don't take it wrong, but women are kingdom mothers, because the mother is the one who is in charge of bringing up and creating a universe. Of course, father is definitely half guilty, but still, she's the one. Today, many women, they're feminists. They don't want to be mothers. If she's a mother, she doesn't want to take care. She wants to be, wants to have a career. She wants to be a great politician, a doctor, an engineer. It's all okay. But your main career is your children, is your child, which is extremely important. If that's not the case, we're going to have a sick young man and then unstable and sick men. Because mothers don't want to be mothers anymore. They just want to have children and say, oh, she's nice, she's so cute, and he's so cute, but then they're out and the society takes care of the kid, and the kid has everything, and he's fed by everything, but he doesn't care about it. And then we have sick society. So that's why the Orthodox Church just divided everything as it should be. And this is a beautiful game. You know, we're just participants of this beautiful divine game. It's like a key and a lock. A man, husband is a key, and wife is a lock. Imagine if key is soft and impotent. Nothing can happen. And the doors are the doors of hell. If the key is not dominant enough, the doors are not going to be open. And if the lock is stiff, or is rusted, you know, doesn't work, the key will break. And anyway, the doors to heaven are not going to be open. So the both are important, and simply the key is dominant, active, the lock is passive. But the importance is absolutely equal. That's how it works, and it's beautiful. You know, when males are impotent, doesn't work. When females are aggressive, doesn't work as well. They're both unsatisfied because it's not normal, it's not natural. And of course, male should be dominant, but full of love and respect towards his wife, and wife should be very, very feminine, very feminine, and she should love her husband, and she should give him strength to say, "Oh, you're my prince. You're the best one. You're the strongest one." Because you know, men, are also weak, and we need support from a woman. You know, and of course, woman needs tenderness. You know, a man has to say to her, "You're my princess. You're the most beautiful in the whole world." And then it works. So God help us to find such a partner. Yes.
What do you think Adam and Eve?
What? Were, Adam and Eve.
How old do you think they were when they were made?
How old they were?
Yeah.
Well, then they say, church fathers say, when we go to the other world, when we die, when this body dies, when we go out there, we're going to be all of us. We're going to be about 33 years old. I really mean they were their bodies were, let's say, that old, or at least they looked old in this way. But we cannot know really how old they were. When they were expelled, let's say, when they tasted from the tree. But, you know, they were young, they were spiritually young, they were supposed to grow, they were supposed to progress in a spiritual way. And they were not mature enough, and they did this stupid move. And since they entered the sin, God gave humanity death, that we should not stay alive eternally being sinful. So that's why the death is given to us, not only death, but virtuous life, and with the death as a crown, that we go through that, cleanse ourselves, and enter going back into the paradise. So that's why they had to be expelled from paradise in order to clean themselves again. So they were young and immature. So you're all going to continue as Orthodox Christians. You're going to be nice and decent, young boys and girls, and you're going to raise your children this way.
After all.
God helps us. Okay, so we can go ahead.
Thank you so much.
Царь Небесный, Дышный, Душа, Истинный, Кусусу, Иисус, Христ, Мы, Ваш, Лица, Бара, Дара, Дара, Бодиса, Руси, Нас, и Чистым, Сокин, Чистым, и Спаси, Дара, Боже, Наши. Слава Отцу, Святому, Святому Духу, Святому, 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 Господу, 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 Отче, Благослови.